This is Rob McConnell wishing each and every one of you a very, very Merry Christmas and a happy, healthy, prosperous New Year. From our home to yours, love, light, and spirituality today and every day from this day forward. Merry Christmas, everyone.
You're listening to the X-Zone Radio Show, live and around the world on the Talkstar Radio Network.
X-Zone Broadcast Network.
UK High Definition Radio.
Euro High Definition Radio.
And Star Cable. Our toll-free telephone number worldwide is 1-800-610-7035.
Our email address, xzone@xzoneradiotv.com.
On MSN Messenger, xzoneradiotv@hotmail.com.
And our website,
www.xzoneradiotv.com.
The X-Zone Radio and TV show is largely an opinion talk show. All opinions, comments, or statements of fact expressed by Rob McConnell's guests are strictly their own and are not to be construed as those of the X-Zone Radio and TV show or in any manner endorsed by Rob McConnell, Relmar McConnell Media Company, Talkstar Radio Network, its affiliated stations, or employees.
All Hit Radio.
Welcome to the X Zone, a place where fact is fiction and fiction is reality. Now, here's your host, Rob McConnell.
Welcome back to the X-Zone, everyone. My name is Rob McConnell, and yes, we're coming to you from our studios in Hamilton, Ontario, Canada. If you'd like to give us a call, worldwide toll-free, 1-800-610-7035. My email address is xzone@xzoneradiotv.com. On MSN Messenger, xzoneradiotv@hotmail.com. And our website, www.xzoneradiotv.com. Once again, X-Zone Nation, I'd like to remind you of a couple of things before we get to our next guest, who is Sonia Barrett. She's the author of The Cosmic Game in 3D, Mastering Reality, Mastering the Matrix of the Mind. First of all, the X-Chronicles for December 2010 is available. All you have to do is go to www.xchronicles-newspaper.com. That's www.xchronicles.com. xchronicles-newspaper.com. That's spelled xchronicles-newspaper.com, and follow the links. It'll bring you to the online version where you can download it, you can print it, you can even download it onto 16 different handheld devices. Once again, that's at www.xchronicles-newspaper.com. And we still have at www.videowaiting.com the very interesting hypothesis that is being presented by Dave Aaron, who's also known as Video Dave, as to what UFO propulsion really is. And he's got a few good videos there that raise a lot of questions. That's at www.videowaiting.com. Sonia Barrett is my guest this hour. She is globally recognized for her unique, in-depth, and humorous style of explaining the nature of reality as not only a virtual reality, but ultimately a game. In 1992, a newly divorced single mother of two sons, Sonia set out to prove her own influence on physical reality amidst the difficulties and the struggles. She was determined to triumph in consciously fusing mind and matter against all odds. She proclaimed a movement upon herself without books or gurus to guide her. She used her determination as her resource. Sonia would eventually penetrate the matrix which has been her desire and ultimate goal. When I come back from this commercial break in 2 minutes, Sonia Barrett is going to be joining me. Her website, www.spiritinform.com. That's www.spiritinform.com. This is The X-Zone. My name is Rob McConnell, and we are coming to you from our studios in Hamilton, Ontario, Canada. Once again, 1-800-610-7035. Email xzone at xzoneradiotv.com. On MSN Messenger, xzoneradiotv@hotmail.com. And our website, www.xzoneradiotv.com. I'll be back on the other side of this 2-minute commercial break with my special guest of this hour, the author of Cosmic Game in 3D, Mastering Reality, Mastering the Matrix of the Mind, Sonia Barrett, here in the X-Zone with yours truly, Rob McConnell, from our studios in Hamilton, Ontario, Canada. Don't go away. Rob McConnell here, presenting an overview for Nicholas Paul Jennings, author of a fascinating book, Amen. It presents facts revealed by Egyptologists, facts that enable us to understand why Amen is the beginning of creation of God. It provides recommendations for religious leaders of the major religions to unify their beliefs and teach the word of God, love one another. Amen informs people how mankind conceived God. It was the Egyptians that developed the concepts of a soul, a hereafter, and son of God. And finally, after the worship of many gods, they conceived the belief in one universal God, the maker of all there is. For more information, visit www.futureofgodamen.com. That's www.futureofgodamen.com. Back in Victorian England, a famous theologian posed a perplexing riddle.
Why are the two top personalities in the Bible tagged with the numbers 7 and 11?
Academics agree the answer is found in the stunning discovery of a hitherto secret Bible structure explained in a new book called The Genesis Grid. The discovery is so simple that preschool children could illustrate it. Certain claims are hugely controversial and may offend some, but at the X-Zone, we've studied this awesome new book and agree with one expert, and I quote,
"These discoveries appear to be beyond coincidence."
So who or what hid this wonderful pattern in the Bible, and what might they do next? Find out more, X-Zone Nation, and read reviews on www.genesisgrid.co.uk. That's
www.genesisgrid.co.uk.
Way offline, you fall into pieces every time, and I don't.
Welcome back, everyone. Sonia Barrett is our special guest. And Sonia, before we went to the commercial break, we were talking about your new book, The Cosmic Game in 3D. And you mentioned a cosmic corporation. Can you explain that to us?
Well, I think, you know, when I did an article based on that, actually. Mm-hmm. But I think when I started examining everything, and we always speak about being controlled and, you know, is there a hierarchical structure in place? And then I think I started to look at our spiritual beliefs, our religious beliefs, those that are worshipped. You know, you have all these mm-hmm. religions looking for a Messiah. You know, I started looking at the whole process, the Lord Maitreya movement, Sanat Kimura, the Ascended Masters. I just started looking at all of it. And, you know, whether we want to believe that these beings exist or not exist, it really doesn't even matter at this point, because there are many people who believe in these forces and mm-hmm. either worship these forces or support these forces or look towards these beings for you know, assistance in how they're going to function in their daily lives. Now, when you look at the bigger picture as to how we look to someone else to determine how life should operate here on the planet, whether we're looking at who is in, you know, God in heaven or whatever the case may be, we can all agree that there are these forces that we acknowledge. And so I started to look at how they, you know, they operate, whether they really operate like that or not. That's how we are perceiving them in terms of how we worship them and how we look to them. So I started to look at our corporate structure. And our corporate structure, of course, is, you know, you have your lower level mm-hmm. and it goes up in terms of management. And so I started to examine that whole process, because that's what's happening. I mean, you can look at your minister in the church. You can look at the people who are members of the church. Then it goes up to the ministers and the deacon, and the same sort of stair level that we've got going to everything. And then who is it that they're worshiping outside of that space? You know, is there then these ascended masters and whatever these other beings or forces that we acknowledge, are they each reporting to another level up? Are there these various levels up? You know, is there an order or a system to, what should I say, orchestrating or intervening then in mm-hmm. life, human life here on the planet? So that's what I started to examine. And of course, in the article and in the book, you know, I go into it a little bit more in terms of really shaping it out for us as to why it would make sense that we're involved in a situation like that. We have to get our ideas from somewhere. So everything that we do here on the planet, and I go back again to our corporate structure, everything we do on the planet is obviously we're simulating something else. It's always a simulation. We're copying some other kind of system, whether we realize it or not. But that's what I started to see, that there probably is their base formulas for various things as to how they operate or how they will exist. And so we do things in accordance with these formulas that are already in place.
Where do you think these formulas originated?
Well, that's a big question. That's a really, really big question there. Where these formulas originated? Because then we have to really begin to go in and examine specifically, you know, what we recognize mm-hmm. as the people who may have come before, what's being discovered by archaeologists and the various historians, and in the pyramids and all the hieroglyphics and all the things that we're trying to decipher, that shows that we've had intervention. We've had other beings potentially show up here on the planet over, you know, a period of time beyond, I think, what we are saying. So we have to examine that. And so, you know, these forces probably, I'm sure, have brought in some of those concepts, those formulas by which we are operating. And so we'd have to take it an even another step further in terms of where did they come from with these, you know, where did those formulas come from for them? Did they also get those concepts from another level up? And it's just like cycles, you know, it's the same thing. Everything is a spin-off. You know, it's a cycle in a cycle in a cycle in a cycle, system in a system in a system. So it becomes sort of difficult to pin down any one specific point where, you know, that formula, you know, may have actually started, but it could actually really just be a spin-off of obviously something much bigger, dwindled down to accommodate our more minuscule or more limited life here on planet Earth.
Let me ask you this. How different do you believe that history is compared to the history that we've been taught?
Oh, I think absolutely, you know, very different. I think that, again, we like packaged concepts, mm-hmm. you know, things that are comfortable for us. And we even see this with scientists in terms of what they will decide that they're going to accept as a possibility. And so we have these governing forces in place that continue to determine what we should know, what society should know, and what they shouldn't know. And so you have this all along, and that is the same thing with history. There are things that were probably not really known clearly at one point, but then when that the information comes out that is more of a truth, then that's shielded from us. And so we might not know about that for another 50 or another 100 years or whatever the case may be. So I think what we have is somebody's story or a variety of stories put together, but it's definitely, they're very limiting is how I see it. Our history is mm-hmm. very limiting, and it is monitored. It's a monitored history. And I think it's more for, obviously, for control, for purposes of control. And I think it has to be up to the individual to question and begin to ask questions and maybe begin to do your research according to just how much you really want to know, because that kind of research is going to be, it's going to be quite heavy and quite intense. So it's up to the individual. And I think the bigger system recognizes that most people don't really, they're not that curious. You know, maybe mm-hmm. not as curious as you and I. I'm to the next level curious. So the history that I've been presented just never made sense to me. And that includes, you know, the religious information from my childhood. It just never made sense to me. Not even at 3 or 4 years old, there are things that just didn't make any sense to me.
I understand and that sentiment perfectly. Let me ask you this, or let me use this example before I get to my next question. We know that history lies. For example, one of the biggest examples that I can think of the top of my head is that Christopher Columbus discovered the Americas, which we know is a lie. We know it's not true, and yet what are kids taught today in school? Who discovered North America? Christopher Columbus. Why don't they just be honest with the kids? Tell them the truth, that it was a bunch of, you know, you've got the Vikings, you've got the Irish monks, and, you know, we are now learning through archaeology that the Mediterranean traded with the Americas, you know, at the time, during the time of Christ, you know, so why not just...
Right.
Why not just tell the kids the truth, and then you'd have no excuse for kids lying to you, because after all, we're lying to them, so why shouldn't they lie to us? That's their logic. How important?
One lie leads to another, though. That's the problem.
Isn't that
true? It's like
the,
all the lies are attached, mm-hmm. and if you change one lie, it's like the you know, the house of cards.
Yeah.
If you know, it affects everything else. And so, you know, now we get into the political stuff, we get into the religious stuff. It affects so many things that they don't want to touch it.
Let me ask you this, Sonia. How important is spirituality in the life of a person living in the year 2011?
I think very important. But again, you know, so now we have to define spirituality mm-hmm. because people get that confused with religion.
Yes.
And I think, you know, spirituality is just you awakening to the fact that there is more to you and really connecting with something deeper, knowing that there's an aspect of you that really goes beyond the physical body and your physical existence and your material existence, and really wanting to be curious and connecting with that part of yourself. To me, that's very, very significant. It might not be for everybody because, you know, you start asking questions, you're going to get answers you don't want, you know, because answers like that start changing your life. And sometimes we're very comfortable with our life. Like, once again, we're comfortable with packaged concepts. We're comfortable with somebody handing us some what to believe. This is why we, you know, we see the situation as it is today, why they're able to get away with continuing to present lies, because the majority are very accepting of it. It's just easier to take what somebody hands to you. So when somebody decides that they want to find out more, they want to connect with that part of them that's much more profound than this physical presentation that we have here, it's going to open up intuition. It's going to open up a connection that really starts to, I think, direct and guide our lives a lot more in terms of what might be workable for us. It might really limit some of the intensity that many of us go through in terms of suffering.
Sonia, please stand by. You and I have to take our commercial break with the news at the bottom of the hour. ExoNation, Sonia Barrett is our very special guest. And if you'd like to find out more about Sonia, her website is www.SovereignMindMagazine.com. That's www.SovereignMagazine.com. And Sonia and I will be back on the other side of this commercial break with this.
From our home to yours, this is Laura Rogers wishing all the members of the X Zone Nation a very Merry Christmas and a happy and joyful New Year.
I'm dreaming of a white Christmas. Just like the ones I used to know.
A witch doctor's power and his ancient tribal ways cruelly collide with the force and authority of modern Africa. Africa is viewed through myriad eyes. You will never forget these characters. A young girl forced to endure a painful, cruel, and antiquated tribal custom. The sole survivor of a vicious tribal massacre. A nun who endures physical assault that compels her to question her faith. A deprived, disadvantaged schoolgirl who is infected with HIV. The translucent soul of a murdered friend. Welcome to Africa's Unfinished Symphony. While the tale of South Africa in the wake of World War II is riveting, violent, and cruel, it is also brimming with stories of kindness, compassion, and courage. Africa's Unfinished Symphony highlights commanding characters who not only bring haunting racial clashes to life, but also convey the intense conflicts that existed between archaic customs and modern influences. You will be captivated as you follow the convoluted path of Farida, of the ancients battling to become Bertha of the modern world. But are the outcomes of her struggle the best results for her and her beloved Africa? Africa's Unfinished Symphony will immerse you in historic African themes that will jolt you out of complacency and into compassion. For more information on how you can get your very own copy of Africa's Unfinished Symphony, visit www.luciaman.com. That's www.luciaman.com.
Hi, this is Eric Rawls of Cosmoverse.com, and you're listening to Rob McConnell in the X-Zone.
Hi, this is Blade Runner, and you are listening to Canada's number one paranormal radio show, The X-Zone, with Rob McConnell.
Hi, I'm Laura Sabrin of Cease to Fields Organic Vineyards in Jordan, and you're listening to Canada's number one paranormal radio show, The X-Zone, with Rob McConnell.
Hi, my name is Lady Ashley, the White Witch of Niagara-on-the-Lake, and you're listening to Canada's number one paranormal talk radio show, The X-Zone, with Rob McConnell.
Welcome to The X-Zone, a place where fact is fiction and fiction is reality. Now, here's your host, Rob McConnell.
Explanation, Sonia Barrett is our special guest. Here's a new website for you, for Sonia and all the great work that she does. www.spiritinform.com. That's www.spiritinform.com. How is the human experience cult-like, and how does it relate to cultural expressions and experiences, Sonia?
Well, in terms of the cult-like experience, when we think about a cult, you know, we're always looking at a brainwashed group of people. Well, ultimately, overall, it seems like that's sort of the majority of, you know, are the way people function on the planet. We sort of have that, what is it, the hive mentality, how we function in terms of our thought process and how easily programmed we are to operate specifically a certain way and without question. And so it becomes pretty much, you know, in my view, of a sort of a cult-like operation. And I know most people don't probably pay attention to it in that sense, because we have a sense that we have all this variety. Like, we're doing this, so we're different, or we're separate. But what is interesting is the fact that we can all have these various options that make us feel, to some degree, very individual, very individualized. But at the same time, there is a base format by which we all tend to operate, and which is why we're such a trendy society, why we gravitate so easily to trends. Whatever the media throws out, we're just very easily programmed and directed. And so when you look at cultures, and I like to break down cultures from it could be the culture of a state. Every state, every town, every city has its own unique way in which the people within that, those spaces, tend to operate. There is always some base formats or formulas by which we tend to function. So I found that to be very interesting, which is why we can say, oh, the people in California, you know, or the people in New York, they're this way. But there is those base ways in which we operate. And so we're very hung up, yes, on our culture in another country. You know, when you leave from one country and you come to the other, you bring your culture with you. But the whole point is that there is a base format by which we tend to operate and get very locked into it. And this is not to say that having a culture, having a way of operation is a good or a bad thing. I'm just simply pointing out how we function and the fact that we get very addicted to it, we get very, very hooked on it. And we are very challenged a lot of times when anything comes in and changes the manner in which we've been programmed to operate based on whatever that particular culture is. And we can say the same thing about, you know, a family. We just have all these various groups or formats by which we function, and then they tend to be a spin-off of a much bigger one. You know, like the United States, there's a specific culture, a specific way in which we think, but then you break that down to each state, and each state will have still yet their own specific way of functioning.
Is it a culture or is it a mindset?
It's a mindset, but at the same time, you know, the word cult comes from the word culture. They're offshoots. So that's why I use that word to broaden it, to really look at that in terms of what we're saying. Either way, yes, it's a mindset. Well, a cult becomes a mindset because it's a program concept that somebody hands to you, and the entire group now has to function that way. We see it in religion, and we see it in, you know, in just a bigger picture. In a company, you have the corporate culture. There's a particular mindset in terms of how that company operates without even having to mention certain things or just unspoken. You come in and you automatically become part of that culture. So it's just the way we are as human beings. And so I don't say it's a good or a bad thing. What I do say is it gives you an opportunity to step back and really begin to recognize how we are influenced, how you as an individual is being influenced. That's what I did. I started to look at the influences in my life in terms of the things I liked or didn't like. Is there an authentic me? Is there a part of me that is really just pure in the sense of, you know, what I'm liking or what I'm choosing to do? Or is everything completely overdosed? You know, is it an overdose of influence? And so, I think that's something to examine. Only for those people who are, you know, asking those kinds of questions as to who am I? Because it's very big, and it does change. It can change your life. It can change, you know, your career. You find out that you're only doing this career because of a particular suggestion or a particular whatever coming from someplace else, someone else, some sort of external influence. So that's what I was asking, the authenticity of the individual, who we are.
What does it mean to hack into our brains or into our bodies?
I also speak about the human body and the entire experience. I compare it to a computer system, and I think that we are seeing that more and more in terms of technology, in terms of even the, you know, transhumanism and all the discussion that's going on. I think their scientists are starting to go ahead, some of them, and embrace the idea that it's very similar. Everything is very similar to how these computers are set up and how we program our computer systems. So I see the human body, you know, as a system. I see it, you know, as a system, like a computer system. And there is that part of you, though, that is in these vehicles, in these vessels, in these vehicles that we call bodies. And so because we have been so heavily programmed, heavily influenced then by programs, by other people's beliefs and so on and so forth in terms of how we should operate and think, I started to recognize that there is a way to begin to sort of, you know, like a computer, hack into yourself, hack into your mind, break into your mind and into your vehicle, which means simply that you're starting to go beyond those programs, which is what I was speaking of right before that. You start to see beyond those programs and start to connect with a more authentic aspect of yourself. And that goes back to looking at the fact that we only use a very small portion of the brain. And the brain, of course, is like the, you know, control center there for the body, this massive computer that controls everything. So you start to look at it from that aspect, you start to see a lot more of what is possible, what is not being accessed. The brain only allows us access to, you know, certain things, although it records everything. You're only given access to certain things. So therefore, we don't remember or recognize or, you know, see everything, even though the brain scans and picks up everything. So it's being able to begin to pierce that veil, get in even deeper, go past just the program concept of reality and what life is and what's possible for the mind, for the thought process, what the mind can do. It is very, very powerful what the mind can do. So that's really okay. What I'm referring to. And of course, the book goes into that in a lot more detail.
Is there really a veil or matrix? And if so, is it possibly, or is it possible to break through this veil of distortion?
Well, yes. I mean, when I speak about the matrix, I often describe it as an invisible, you know, it's an invisible space then. Mm-hmm. It's sort of looking as if we are in a sphere, but yeah. There is no physical shell that you can really see, but it's this womb then, let's say, the space that we're in, that we're having this particular experience that we call the human experience. And I do see that there are boundaries in terms of, you know, what we have been programmed to or what we have accepted in terms of what our limitations are. And I think that there is that possibility of stepping, piercing the veil, which goes back to what I was speaking about a few minutes ago as well, is to be able to go beyond those boundaries. And we see that, again, with science. What scientists may have known 200 years ago, 100 years ago, and we see what we are allowing ourselves to discover now. And that's really what it comes down to as well. What we will allow ourselves to accept as a possibility, that's really what becomes the dividing point. Because when we are closed off and we decide that, we're going to put boundaries and we say that this is not possible, you can't go beyond this point, then we can't go beyond that point.
We set our own limitations.
Exactly. And so perception becomes mm-hmm. really the magic in this whole experience, is how far will you allow your perception to go? And so, yes, so then we end up in this invisible space, confined to a particular way of thinking, confined to a limitation in terms of what we think that is possible for a human being to achieve and to do and to experience. So there is piercing that veil. I say there are no boundaries. That's the conclusion I've come to. I think no matter how, even in science, we might find conclusions, you know, is that conclusion only good for today? You know, is it going to be just for another week? We will always be lifting the veil off of a greater and greater or deeper and deeper truth as to how anything functions or exists in terms of, you know, what we call reality or life. So I don't see any limitations. What I know today is minuscule in terms of what I may come to understand next week. Now, it doesn't mean that what I know today is wrong. I'm just going to enter into a deeper level of truth and understanding of what I knew last week and this moment.
I was wondering if you could tell us what group mind deception is.
Well, I look at group mind deception in terms of, I guess it sort of goes back to some of what I said earlier. It's like the Borg mentality. And I have talked quite a bit about, some of the New Age information. And I think a lot of what I've seen is that, the indication is this. It's as if we can't move forward, or you can't move forward, or I can't move forward unless the entire group moves forward. And I don't see that. I don't see that at all. This is a really big question, because then it goes into, again, taking the lid off what you think reality can be. And I think that really sets some boundaries, because when we are saying that we have to move forward together, it really puts some boundaries on what reality could potentially be. Now we put ourselves back in that Borg type mentality. And what I see is that the individual, even though we are one collectively, you know, when mm-hmm. we look at it, even from a scientific standpoint, right. Energetically, everything is connected. Absolutely. Everything is connected and ultimately one. But we as individuals represent or are given the opportunity then to have or present a unique and what we would call an individualized experience. It's like this, the one has the illusion of being the many. And so each of us has that uniqueness. Well, in that uniqueness, we still have the opportunity to individually expand, and we don't have to wait for a group to have that kind of expansion.
Stand by, Sonia. You and I have to take our final break. Interesting Hour, Exonation with Sonia Barrett. www.spiritinform.com. That's www.spiritinform.com. We'll be back on the other side of this break. Don't you dare go away.
I'm William S. Peckham. If you enjoy a good mystery with a touch of the paranormal, then you'll love my novel, From Out of the Woodwork. It's the story of a young Toronto contractor, Sean Kennedy, who buys derelict homes, guts them, and turns them into multifamily dwellings, slums just waiting to happen. When Sean buys 29 Livery Lane, the house fights back. Former owners unexpectedly come out of the woodwork as he starts the destruction. The apparitions come to him when he touches old books, reads hidden letters, rummages through old boxes, finds a locket, or reads a discovered manuscript of a murder mystery. From Out of the Woodwork will take you from 1899 to the horror of the World Trade Center, September 11, 2001. Check out From Out of the Woodwork on my website, www.williamspeckham.com.
The new nonfiction book, Razor of Madness, is similar to cult movies like Clockwork Orange, Dragon's Tattoo, or The Other Side of Hell. Wayne Morin Jr. and Thomas Lee Howe will expose widespread and systematic deficiencies in this thought-provoking tell-all novel. Mind control rages among scholars and law schools. Human rights are ignored while thought reform and mental manipulation are accepted practices used as behavior modification. Dr. Louis Jolyon West comes to mind. Media and public scrutiny shows that United States mental hospitals are in fact destructive murder industries. Razor of Madness, expose novel, details this epidemic through an in-depth professional and personal investigation. For decades, there has been a revolving door policy that still releases killers and pedophiles back into society. The maestro of mind control continues to haunt America to this very day. Razor of Madness is available in paperback or as a downloadable ebook at Amazon.com. If you enjoy reading a good mystery with a touch of the paranormal, then you'll love From Out of the Woodwork by William S. Peckham. Sean Kennedy, a Toronto contractor, buys derelict houses, guts them, and turns them into multifamily dwellings. When Sean buys 29 Livery Lane, a century house in ruins, and starts the renovation, the house fights back. He is visited by ghosts of owner's past. His visions are triggered by touching an oak mantle, reading a faded letter, opening an old locket, or opening a brand new casket in the basement. These visions will take you on a trip across southern Ontario from Niagara Falls to Toronto to Kingston. From Out of the Woodwork is now available in paperback and on your favorite electronic reader. To order your copy of From Out of the Woodwork, go to www.williamspeckham.com. That's www.williamspeckham.com.
Thank you. How easy it would be to show me how you feel. More than words is all you have to.
Sonia Barrett is our special guest this hour. www.spiritinform.com. She's the author of The Cosmic Game in 3D, Mastering Reality, Mastering the Matrix of the Mind. Here, let me ask you this. There's a lot of talk and a lot of hype about December 21st, 2012, Sonia. What are your insights regarding this date?
Well, I see that particular time of 2012, as we know, it's the ending and the beginning. Mm-hmm. It's the ending of a cycle and the beginning of a new cycle. And I think that more than anything else, that's what we have to keep in mind, is that reality as we know it operates on cycles, like, you know, like everything else. It's all cycles. And you have a cycle, what is this, the ending of a 104,000 year cycle. And of course, that cycle is divided into, you know, many other cycles, four cycles more uniquely, which is, I think, like 26,000 year cycles. And then it's broken down, you know, from that size, from the 26,000 years into several others. And so, you know, now we're looking at the zodiac and we're looking at the movement of the planet. So I think for me, keeping it in perspective and keeping it simple, mm-hmm. as to this is all natural, this is nothing so crazy and so outrageous. This is just the ending of one cycle. We turn everything into major mysticism.
Yeah.
And it's just so over the top. It's just like you're turning, you know, you have a birthday.
Yeah.
You know? Okay, now I'm 10. Okay, so I've completed this 10-year cycle and now I'm 20, another 10-year cycle. So I've got 20 years. So, you know, we have to keep it in perspective and recognize that that's all that's happening. Yes, there are some shifts that are taking place, because along with those cycles are, I believe this is my concept, that all of these cycles, like for the 26,000 years, and there's four of them, I mean, that add up to the 104,000 years, they each carry some specifics. And I think, again, it's based on, you know, frequency or vibration, the frequency that each hold. And I think in that context, there are evolutionary shifts that are taking place, that will take place, that have been taking place. And so we're just shifting into another theme or another concept, you know, in this new cycle that's going to be happening.
Or as I like to say, yeah, the Mayans are taking the old calendar off the wall, putting the new one up.
Exactly. Yeah. You know, it's really just that simple. And yeah, there's lots of things that are going to go on the planet, but that's all part of the cyclic shift. Yeah. So everything is just doing what it naturally does. And this is just a tiny cyclic shift in comparison to the endless and the bigger cycles that are going on that's affecting this one. That we,
Sonia, you and I have to say so long for tonight. I want to thank you very much for joining us. Great talking to you. Continued success. And Exonation Sonia Barrett has been my guest. Her website is www.spiritinform.com, and she is the author of The Cosmic Game in 3D, Mastering Reality, Mastering the Matrix of the Mind. We'll be back on the other side of this commercial break as the X-Zone continues from our studios in beautiful Hamilton, Ontario, Canada. My name is Rob McConnell. Whatever you do, don't go away. We'll be right back.